today.
Hello, everybody. This is Josh Price, and you are listening to the Mark Price for Three podcast. Each episode, my dad will be talking NBA basketball, sharing some coaching and instruction, and of course, talking about his faith. Without further delay, here's my dad, Mark Price.
Welcome back to the Mark Price for Three podcast, episode 96. Today, we have a special guest. It's been a minute since Sam has been on. It's Labor Day weekend. How you guys doing? Mark, we'll start with you. How are you doing?
Doing good, man. Doing good. It's been a fun, busy weekend. I think I told you we kind of had a staycation this weekend with Caroline and baby Lily. So the only bad part is yesterday she got a little sick and started throwing up. So that was disappointing. But we've had so much fun all the way up to that point. But yeah, it was fun. Josh was here hanging out with us too because his wife was out of town doing some things.
A little family time. That's good. That's always good. How many shots did Lily get up this weekend?
Hey, it was great. It was so awesome. Like, you know, I sent you the picture of like their first basket, right? Or put the ball in the hoop. Well, she came over and we kind of just handed her this little ball and she went straight to the hoop.
Yeah, she did.
Put it in. So she knows, man. She knows. She knows.
It's in her DNA. It's in her DNA. Well, Sam, how are you? How's your Labor Day weekend so far? Welcome back, by the way.
Oh, thanks. Thanks again for having me. Yeah, it's been, you know, pretty relaxing, which is nice. August, September, always kind of slower months for me, for what I do. But, you know, training camp's going to be here by the end of the month, really, or a month from today. So just getting ready to get back into it. But yeah, Labor Day weekend has been really nice. And then things are going to get pretty hectic today, hanging out with a lot of friends, some of my old CBCA classmates. And we're all going to cook out and, you know, we get together quite often, actually. So for those in the Northeast Ohio listening area, I'm a CBCA alum. And it's interesting because we had, you know, smaller school at the time, but all of our classmates remain pretty close and our families. And we get together about every Saturday night at least when I can. I think they do it every Saturday and I get there when I can. And play cards and get a free meal and all that. So today we'll be grilling out for Labor Day. So I always look forward to that.
What time should I head up that way if you're grilling?
Yeah, it's free. You'll be surprised how many people that didn't go to CBCA actually show up. I'm like, who are these people? You know? They're like, whatever. They know where the free food is.
That's right. The grill's hot. Okay.
Right. Yeah.
So you mentioned it, August, September, and honestly, all summer, Mark and I've kind of pieced together the podcast because there just hasn't been a lot to talk about. Yeah, we had USA basketball and, you know, some drama there, things like that. But we wanted to get you back on today because it is starting to ramp up in terms of the Cavs. We've talked a little bit here or there about some of the moves the Cavs have made this summer. Can you kind of recap that? And then in segment two, I really want to get into a lot of what you report on hoopswire.com. A lot of the breaking news. Mark and I typically share tweets from you about the latest on the Cavs. So we'll talk about that in segment two. But, you know, for now, let's just talk about where the Cavs are in terms of they spent a lot of money this summer. That's for sure.
Yeah, with all the extensions, for sure. You know, look, their big change was obviously the coaching change. And I think they're banking on Kenny Atkinson to, you know, I don't think there's any question Darius Garland be one of the first to admit he had a down year last year. So, you know, they want to get that corrected. And I think that that's one reason you bring in a new coach and Kenny Atkinson. I think that he sold, look, we'll get Darius Garland to another level. We'll get Evan Mobley to another level offensively. Defensively, he and Jared Allen are already pretty much elite. You know, I mean, they're one of the best defensive front courts, but how do we get them to be at their best next to each other offensively? And I think that was a big selling point for Kenny Atkinson. I think that was one of the questions that the Cavs front office asked. And how do we get all of these guys to another level and fit in well with Donovan Mitchell? Obviously, that's your core four. How do you make all that work? And consistently, you know, how do you get them all to play well consistently together as a unit? And I think that was, you know, that was their big change. Obviously, they committed to all of those guys when it all started when Donovan Mitchell signed his contract extension and then Evan Mobley. and then Jared Allen, which was a very team-friendly deal. So I think they're excited about the coaching change in terms of what Kenny Atkinson's going to bring. As much as respect as they had for J.B. Bickerstaff, who I think is going to do a great job in Detroit, because that's a perfect, seems like a perfect situation for him. But as far as the Cavs go, look, they're one of three teams that haven't signed free agent to a standard contract. Now, they signed JT Thor to a two-way deal. So he was an outside free agent. But the Lakers, the Cavs, and the defending champion Celtics are the only three teams that haven't signed a free agent that's to a standard contract. And I think for the Cavs, there's a reason for that. It's, let's see how this goes. You know, if we have to make a move, we have all the way until February. So I think that they're excited about that. The vibe I'm getting is the new coach and kind of a new philosophy and a new system and a fresh voice. They at least want to see how that goes. And you know, look, they talk trade just like everybody else in the offseason, but there's nothing that moved the needle. Or if they, you know, people were asking them for some of their best players and didn't want to give up anything. And they were just, why bother with that? So again, there's, you know, you find out what you have a little while to figure it out. And if it doesn't work out for some reason or another, well, the trade deadline's not till February. So I know a lot of fans always get on me because they haven't made a move or made a trade, but I think that there's something to be said for familiarity. And I think that's the route that they're going to at least start at.
And Mark, you've said that about Kenny Atkins, right? That's been your feeling all along, was, hey, give me a year, right? What are your thoughts?
Yeah, Mark? I think obviously that was Kenny's selling point coming in, was, hey, look, I think I can get them to another level. Give me a chance with these guys. And I think the Cavs front office, you know, want that. I mean, they have that. They want to see that work. I mean, these are the guys they brought in and they want to build around. And so I agree with Sam on that, that's the play. Now, from a fan standpoint, you know, an excitement level, I think I would say probably people are wanting a little bit more just at what's that missing piece. Because, I mean, it's one thing to say, okay, you know, like, let's take our team first. I mean, we were right there above all, and we got beat by the greatest player on one of the greatest shots that's ever been made. That's how close we were. But this current Cavs team, I mean, they kind of got crushed by the Knicks 2 years ago. And then even though they won their first round series, I think most people expected them to kind of dominate the Orlando Magic in that first round, and it didn't happen. And then obviously, you know, the second round with the, you know, Celtics and all that fell apart pretty quickly. But so I think there's a lot of kind of wait and see, and there, yeah, I think it's a big season for these guys. There's a lot of money been paid. I think a lot of people are like, it's put up or shut up time with this group. Okay, let's run it back. But like, to Sam's point, if it's not working, it doesn't look like it's working. Again, it'll be interesting to see it, the pressure that mounts on making a move by that trade deadline in February, like you said, Sam. So, you know, from my standpoint, I like the fact that they're kind of keeping a core group together. I'm a big believer in that. But I think come playoff time, these guys still got to show they can step it up and take it to another level. I don't think they've shown that really in the last 2 years. And so that's the question mark, I think, that's still kind of hanging out there, if there is one with these guys. And it's not that they don't like these players, whatever, but you know as well as I do, at the end of the day, it's, you got to win. That's what the league's about. And so it's going to be a big year. It's going to be a lot of pressure, I think. More pressure on this team than it's been the last couple of years. I think everybody's like, oh, we're still young, we're still growing. I think you can throw all that out the window. Right now, the Cavs are supposed to be good. They're supposed to be one of the elite teams in the East. Now let's see if they can do it.
In this next segment, there's a lot of trade rumors. There's a lot of things going on. Where do you know the assets? And I don't want you to be a capologist. I just, where do the Cavs stand in terms of what could they do how much flexibility they have. I know they paid out a lot of money. How much flexibility they have right now?
Well, they don't have a ton of flexibility when you talk about bringing in a free agent. You would be, you know, and Mike Ganzi, their GM, brought this up, said, you know, with these new, the new collective bargaining agreement, and the second tax apron and all this, now the penalties used to just be monetary, where you would pay a certain amount in penalty tax if you went over the cap. Now it limits everything. And all that took was a GM convincing the owner, hey, could you pay this tax? And the owners would be, sure, you know, not a problem. Well, now it impacts general managers in that you can't make as many moves. You can't trade your picks. You can't acquire picks. It really limits what GMs can do. And that's really changed the whole dynamic of roster construction. And you're better off doing what the Cavs and the Celtics have done, which is not really bring in any new free agents, because you're going to be better off financially and have more wiggle room if you re-sign your own guys, as opposed to, you know, trying to go out and get another star. The days of these super teams are, with this new collective bargaining agreement, are pretty much over. You know, you have to, it encourages teams to build from within, much like in Mark's era. You know, guys weren't teaming up. You were kind of building organically your teams, and then you would add pieces through the draft or trades. Free agency played a little bit of a role, but not to the way it does today. So with that said, the Cavs are going to be a little bit limited in terms of, that's a one big reason why they have been one of those three teams that haven't signed a free agent. You know, you look, there's plenty of veteran free agents out there. We run them every day on HoopsWire by position, that you can see every available free agent. And there's plenty of guys that you think, well, this guy might be able to help, but, you know, at what cost? So I think that that's one big thing that they've looked into. Obviously, you know, they still have to figure out at this recording of what's going on with Isaac Okoro, he's the only restricted free agent left on the market right now. Which of course means somebody else could give him an offer and the Cavs could match. I suspect at this point that Okoro is going to be back, because he, you know, those other offers have not come, and sign in trades. There's been plenty of interest. I know that the Detroit Pistons and JB Bickerstaff had really shown some interest in Okoro, but at this point, most teams have their rosters pretty much set. And I think, you know, Isaac can pick up his qualifying offer and then test unrestricted free agency next summer. That seems like that's going to be the case. So, you know, look, they've had a couple of trade talks and conversations, and I think that they know or feel like they need help around the edges. We don't know what they're going to do for backup center. And here we are a month away from camp. You know, there's been no deal with Tristan Thompson. I don't know that they're even planning, even had any talks with him. Damian Jones isn't going to be back. Isaiah Mobley, who kind of was going up through the G League and development system, is not, you know, he's not signed anywhere. I don't know that they'll be bringing him back. So you've got to find, you've got, I don't know, 3 or 4 weeks to find some big guys, at least to bring into camp and back up Jared Allen and Evan Mobley. Because as we know, guys, there's always injuries, probably more today than ever. Sure. So you've got to shore up your depth there. And they're going to find a way to do that. I don't know how they're going to go about that, but, you know, that's one thing that they're really looking to do. Camp, and I'll tell you this, you know, as far as backup point guard, people say, well, you got to look at that. Ty Jerome's ready to go from everything I've heard. And you've got Craig Porter Jr. And then, of course, you drafted Jalen Tyson, who had a really nice run in summer league, who plays really both guard spots, 6'7". And, you know, so you've got them, obviously, Caris LeVert, Okoro, and Sam Merrill. So I think that they're pretty short up at the wing and the guard spots, and Max Strus, the starter. But it's that, you know, backup bigs in the front court that they know that they have to shore that up. But I'm sure they have some plans to do that.
Well, we're big Ty Jerome fans, so at least I am.
I think it could be. Hey, I look at it this way. They've only lost one time when he's played more than 5 minutes. So
And Mark and I were there. Mark and I went to one game together, and we got cooked by Ty Jerome when he was with Golden State. So I think we want to see Ty Jerome do well. Mark, what questions do you have for Sam when it comes to trades and free agency and all those kind of things?
Well, I do have one question I have for Sam, because I've noticed it lately. It's this word that you use in a lot of when it refers to somebody urging the Cavs to do this, or somebody urges. Who's doing the urging, I guess, would be my question. I don't want to, you know, give away your like secret, whatever connections, but I've just thought that that wording has been interesting and you've been using it a lot lately. So I was just kind of curious, you know, is it people that, you know, other GMs, or, you know, who's the guy that's urging the Cavs, you know, to do this or that?
A lot of times it will be, since we last spoke, guys, I hired a full-time writer, which has been a real blessing that I've been able to do that. Just take a little burden off me. So I'm going to blame him. he writes all those, but he does a great job. Ashish Mathur is his name, and he does a fantastic job. But a lot of times that'll be a scout, anonymous scout, a rival anonymous scout, opposing executive GM type. A lot of times it could be another writer, you know, but which we will name if it's another writer or an NBA insider from the ESPN or something. But yeah, so I mean, it could be a different player. We use the word urge because we found that that's been more, it draws more traffic. Just that one word. So it's kind of how the game is played a little bit there.
Okay.
And I kind of encouraged them to, let's make it sound like they really need to do this, because, you know, but, you know, a lot of times the person who's telling us this, or we're getting that information from, is kind of making it sound like this is what they really need to do. Right. So yeah, those are, we do those. We do, Ashish also does a lot of trade proposals, which are hypothetical.
Right.
And we tried them out, and I was like, well, I don't know, you know, I don't know if I like these hypothetical trade proposals. They seem kind of spammy. But yeah. I'll tell you what, they're very well read. They're fun to write. I don't write them because I feel like when I write stuff like that, people are going to kind of say, well, Amico says, you know, this or that's going to happen, when in reality, it's a hypothetical. So, but those do well. The urges do well. And I'll tell you this, Mark, out of the urging and the trade proposals and stuff, I never suspect any of those will actually ever come true. And I don't think that that really influences anybody's making. I sure hope it wouldn't anyway.
Right. No, I just thought it was interesting. And so it's, you know, I kind of figured that was the case. But, you know, it's just, I know this competition to kind of whatever, get the word out, and, you know, this trade and that trade, keep interest going. But yeah, I think all that stuff is interesting. So, and I know a lot of other people do as well. But I, you know, to backtrack a little bit, Sam, I just want to get your thoughts a little bit. Aaron and I have kind of shared ours to a certain extent, but this summer with the Olympics and the USA basketball. And, you know, we've kind of talked here that, you know, it used to be, yeah, we got the gold, we dominated, whatever. You know, this year kind of felt like we got it done, kind of, you know, and we've talked about this before, you know, kind of the reality and the kind of just the feelings that go into things. We talked about, you know, the difference in like the Pacers beating the Knicks versus the Cavs beating the Magic, that the two franchises walk away, have two different feelings about that in a certain extent, even though they both won. And I think my own take, and I'll just be, get your interest in that, you know, it's, I don't think anybody sees the USA as the dominant basketball. I mean, obviously they still have the most superstars and things like that, but, you know, you're probably a couple years away of not having guys like Durant and LeBron and Steph Curry. You take those guys off that team, USA basketball probably doesn't win that tournament. I mean, mm-hmm. what, you know, I'd just be interested to get your thoughts where we are right now comparatively with the way that the world is building basketball and the effects it's showing itself in these international competitions.
Yeah, I think you just said it. Without those three guys who probably aren't going to be playing in 2028, I wouldn't suspect, although with those three, you never know. But I mean, if those three guys, you take them off this team, and I don't know that they win this, because those guys, whether it was LeBron or Steph, obviously we saw, or Durant, one of those guys always stepped up big in kind of these moments where you're starting to sweat it out a little bit. And yeah, the rest of the world has really, you know, with guys like Jokic, Doncic, who didn't play this year for Slovenia, you look at some of the stars, Antetokounmpo with Greece, Team Canada has a great team. Germany won the FIBA World Cup. They're very united. Dennis Schroeder is like an NBA, four-time NBA All-Star when he plays for Germany, you know. So right. They've got the Wagner guys from Orlando. So there's just so much, like you said, that, yeah, the NBA had these three huge, or I'm sorry, Team USA had these three huge NBA stars in LeBron and Curry and Durant, guys who were championship level winners. And then you take those guys off the team. We saw what happened at FIBA, which Team USA did not win. Germany won that. And Team USA did not have LeBron, Durant, or Curry in the FIBA tournament. So, and which I found a little bit interesting, it seems almost like the FIBA tournament is a bigger deal to the international players than the Olympics. So I've always found that interesting. But yeah, I think that you've got to find, now, you know, a lot can happen in 4 years. You can get new American stars coming in. Who knows what Cooper Flagg, for instance, what his level of contribution is going to be. Maybe some players from this year's rookie class. I still think the U.S. overall, if you're talking about 12 guys, probably has the best 12, you know, not 1 through 12, but 12 of the absolute best players in the world. And it's all about fit and unity when you're talking about building a team. You know, we saw Kawhi Leonard go home, and they brought in not another NBA All-Star, but they brought in Derek White, you know, from the Celtics. So I think that there's a lot they recognize. This isn't an All-Star team. Team USA can't be an All-Star team. It's got to be a team in the truest sense. And I think that they recognize that. And yeah, they're probably sweating it out a little bit, like, well, you know, 2028, we've got to make some adjustments and get this figured out, because this is, like you said, phew, it was very close.
Well, no doubt. And you know, just watching the draft, you know, this year's draft and things like that, and it seems to be coming more and more the case that the top four or five picks now every year are coming from other countries, you know, and things like that. And so when you start saying, okay, the new guys, you know, Wimby or whoever it is, I mean, these guys are playing for other countries in these international competitions. They're not playing for the United States. I mean, Joel Embiid, I mean, actually could have played for France.
Yeah, you know? And they really would have been in trouble.
you know, and so, you know, I think it's going to be a challenge for sure moving forward in the development. We've obviously gotten into that. There's obviously, you know, and you see these teams, and they play a lot more together in the off season. I think these other guys from these other countries, and they play for their teams in these, like you said, these FIBA events and different things. And so there's a much more of a camaraderie, you know, and how you develop that in the States. I don't know, because it's always kind of been an all-star type selection process, especially when the pros have taken place. Now in college, you know, I've talked about this with Aaron, you know, I got a chance to play for the Pan American team in college, and that was a tryout. That was, you know, going back to, you know, the good old days of Vexa showing up and having 40, 50 college guys, you know, just trying out against each other and trying to make the, you know, the team to represent the United States. And I felt that way it was, you were picking a team, you know, that you felt like that had shooters, big guys and rebounders and all the different things, all the different pieces that you need to be successful in international competition. And let's face it, it's a different style of play than regularly over here in the States. So, you know, I think more of that process. And I think to your point, I thought pickup like a Derek White and a Drew Holiday were excellent picks for the American team this year, because you had your superstar kind of guys, but what guys are, which we talked about, are winners, you know, guys that just are about winning. And Drew Holiday's, you know, one of those guys. I mean, you just look at his resume now. I mean, the guy's, I don't know what people think of him individually, but his record, he's put himself in Hall of Fame talks for sure, right? Because he's got championship, you know, multiple championships and now gold medals. And I mean, it's just, the guy's proven that he's a winner, you know.
Yeah.
It's not about stats. It's not about putting up numbers. It's not about impressions or tweets on the thing. I mean, those kind of guys, which is hard to find at the NBA level, let's face it, because there is so much money involved and different things now. But I mean, you got to give, you know, the Celtics and Brad Stevens and all those guys a ton of credit. I mean, of course, they got the Jason Tatums and the Jaylen Browns. Then the rest of that team they put together are guys that love to win, they play to win, and they don't care about anything else. And that's how you get it done.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's probably one thing that's never changed about the NBA. As much stuff as has changed, Mark, is you've got to find a roster that fits. And you've got to find guys who are willing to give up maybe, you know, the individual stuff to win. And that just hasn't ever changed. And it, you know, you can thrill the fans with a bunch of dynamic individuals for a regular season. And if it doesn't fit, it's not going to win you a championship. I think we saw that a little bit with the Phoenix Suns last year. And there are countless examples of that, Mark. Going back to your day, we remember when the Atlanta Hawks got Moses Malone and Reggie Theus and had Dominique Wilkins, and it just didn't work. So I think we see that quite a bit in the NBA. But yeah, to your point, I think that Boston clearly has that kind of connectivity with their guys. And I think that's what the Cavs are aiming for by keeping everyone together as well.
Yeah, that's exactly right.
I love what you said, because I have noticed many of, like Mark said, so actually one thing I'm going to do now is I'm going to use urges in my tweets about Mark's podcast if it gets us.
Hey, I'll tell you what, it works.
All right. So Mark Price urges Aaron not to make the connection between Rodman and Peter. It would be one of the first tweets I'll do. But no, one of the things, you've put together some great packages. And so that's the other thing you covered there. So I want to go around the horn. Who is the one guy? Because I know mine. So I'll go first. Cam Johnson. His name keeps coming up on Hoops Wire. And every time I get real excited, because I would love to see Cam Johnson on the Cavs. I think it's a perfect fit. I think he'd be great to spread the floor. Plus, he's a Tar Heel. So, you know, I want Cam Johnson. But that would be the one guy. Mark, who's, is there somebody that you say, you know, you've seen that, I don't even know if they're available, but is there somebody that you've seen that say, you know, that's the next piece, that's the missing piece. He's the Drew Holiday, the Derek White for the Cavs.
Yeah, I don't really know. I know the Cam Johnsons, and there's a couple other guys, but you know, to me, and Okoro, to me, Okoro's a guy that could become that guy. Obviously the missing piece for him is the shooting piece, which is a huge piece, but a three and D guy, you know, for sure. Because let's face it, the four headed offensive monster, you know, other, you know, guard wise, they need a guy that can guard the other best perimeter player. But that's hurt the Cavs, I think, you know, in particular. So a guy that can guard, got some size, but also, you know, can make that 3-point shot on a more consistent basis and stretch the floor, I think would be huge. And, you know, you look at Struess and you think, okay, he could be that guy. He's not, you know, size wise, maybe like, you know, the way the NBA is going with the bigger wings and things like that, you might like a guy that's a little bit bigger. And I've mentioned this before. I mean, I think if the Cavs could find that one piece, I think Struess's biggest value is what he would bring coming in off the bench, you know, with his energy and his shooting and things like that. You know, I think that's his perfect role and, you know, in a perfect scenario. But obviously I'm sure he probably sees himself as a starter now and in that sort of thing. But, you know, he's got to really step it up, I think, from kind of what they hoped they would get from him last year when he moved in that starting spot. But yeah, that's the one piece. And I don't know who the guy would be. You know, I can, Sam may have some more names that are out there that could be a fit, but yeah, that's kind of just without a, you know, a name, just the idea of that position. That's what I kind of see.
Sam, what do you think?
Yeah, you know, and I know that we've heard, I agree. And I think the Cavs are very aware of that, you know, hey, we would like to bring in this 6'8" guy who's kind of a 3-and-D guy who has some size. I know that they have talked a little bit. I think a lot of teams have with the Nets because of Cam Johnson. We saw, you know, the Nets obviously are in a rebuilding stage where they traded Mikal Bridges to the Knicks, which was a big move for New York. And, you know, certainly Cam Johnson is one of those guys who's available. I know that the Nets, you know, they haven't moved him yet. And there's a reason, because they're probably asking what other teams see as more than his value. I'm sure they want draft picks, which the Cavs do not have, because, you know, they gave those up in the Donovan Mitchell trade. So, you know, there's that. That's the name that comes up for a lot of teams, Cam Johnson. And I think that's the kind of guy that they could certainly, I mean, 6'8" guy who can knock it down is certainly a type of player. I think somebody who, I was just thinking this last night, I was going through our list, and actually this guy's agent texted me and said, hey, how come he's not on your list of free agents? So I put him on there. And you know, you'll be happy. It's another Carolina guy, I believe, Nasir Little.
Yeah. Oh, he'd be great.
He was let go by the Suns.
Right. Tough as nails.
Right. 6'6" guy, 6'7". Obviously, I think at this point Yeah, that's his problem, is he's not a shooter. But I think at this stage, if the Cavs are going to sign somebody, the Suns let him and E.J. Liddell go, the former Ohio State big guy, at the same time couple weeks ago. I think those guys, those type of players, not necessarily those two, but those type of guys who are kind of the last chance saloon guys that could, you know, come in and hey, we're going to give you every opportunity, show us what you can do. I think that's kind of the guys that they're going to spin through the wheels to start the season. Let's get some of these veteran guys, maybe who used to be first round or were once first round picks, maybe even a lottery pick that came into the league with kind of high hopes and just haven't flourished, but are still young, and see what they can do. I think that those guys are kind of more realistic, but yeah, theoretically at some point you may see this roster and say, we're very desperate for that 3-and-D guy. We're going to have to make some kind of deal. And certainly the Cavs do have some pieces. They don't want to mess with the core four, but around the edges, if they had to make a deal, they certainly have that possibility. But I think, again, let's see what we got to work with here. Let's see how it goes. Let's see how the new coach gets these guys to play, if they can all raise their level a little bit, and then we'll revisit it and make a deal that way if we have to. So I was excited though, Aaron, because I got to throw out a Carolina name for you. So I saw that last night.
I thought you were going to say Danny Green. I'm like, is he still kicking around the league?
He's doing television now.
Carolina doesn't have a lot of them bouncing around anymore. Harrison Barnes, maybe Reggie Bullock. I don't know if he's still kicking. You know, it's not like it used to be in the 80s when every best player was from Carolina. So I do like Nasir Little.
I don't know about that. There was a time.
They were a factory.
Georgia Tech had the most guys in the NBA.
Right.
There was a time.
Well, as point guards. If you needed a point guard, you went to Georgia Tech, because that was point guard you for a long time. So yeah, as we grind through the gears to transition to the faith segment, I wanted to bring up something. I know I'm in the podcasting world. Obviously, Mark played in the league. Sam, you're a journalist. We all take hits. We all take haters. That's just the world we live in. People have opinions on things. And so I wanted to transition for the faith segment today to ask you guys, Romans 1:17, one of the lines says that it's the righteous will live by faith. And I think in a world where we all, you know, probably get mean tweets or, you know, fans would yell at Mark from the stands or wherever it might be, you know, maybe somebody didn't like something I said on a podcast, like Rodman is Peter, and whatever it might be that we, you know, there are haters in the world and there's things that, you know, are said to us, but according to Romans 1:17, we're supposed to live by faith. And in our professions, so to speak, and anyone else listening, how do we do that? So Mark, I'll start with you and then, you know, we'll get Sam's feedback.
Yeah, I think obviously we live in a world right now that's very combative in a lot of ways. I mean, and very instant. I mean, you could tweet something out and if someone doesn't like it, you're going to get a response in literally less than 2 seconds.
Right.
You know, and, you know, I think it just goes back to even when, you know, when I played and things like that. And, you know, anytime you're a player, particularly a star player on a team, and expectations are there and people expect certain things, and, you don't play well in a certain game or whatever, you're going to get criticized for that. And I know it's an old like saying from a long time ago, and you know, but it's something that I always kind of always held dear, and it really rang true for me, is that you can please some of the people some of the time, but you can never please all the people all the time. Mm-hmm. And I think if you get caught up into wanting to get likes or wanting to have people talk good about you and you're living or making decisions on that, you're going to get yourself in, you know, you have to know what you believe in. And that goes to, you know, the verse that you just read. And, you know, we're to play or work or speak or talk for an audience of one. Mm-hmm. And we talk about that all the time here on this podcast, and to honor our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And yeah, sometimes you're going to get criticized for that, but at the end of the day, who do you want to please? Mm. You know, but faith is to walk by faith and not by sight. The scripture talks about, you know, we're human beings and we like to see things and we like to touch things and we like to, you know, but things that are quote unquote right in front of us. And yet we know that when we're dealing with spiritual things, our relationship with God, there's a lot of things that aren't seen and you can't touch and you can't see right at the moment. But yet that's when our faith comes into play, and that our faith is in not how I feel or what's going on at the moment, but what God said in his word. Mm-hmm. And what he did for us on the cross. And, you know, if you keep your faith and your focus on that, you know, then he's going to, through the power of the Holy Spirit, going to help to guide our steps. And we'll be able to walk that path that he has us on and not get distracted, if that makes sense.
Yeah. Sam, how about you?
Yeah. You know, I think that's hit the nail on the head. Is it's really, and Mark said it, we live in a very reactionary society now where everything you say has to have a reaction. And it can be easy to get caught up in that a little bit, especially with my job, because, you know, my whole business is communication. And I remember the first time that, you know, I wrote something. I was starting my own website. I didn't think anybody was reading it. And like the first comment I got was, you know, you're a hack and blah, blah, blah. While true, no one's ever said that to my face. So I, you know, it hurt my feelings. And I was really, it really got me down, because I thought, well, I'm working so hard on the site. I want people to enjoy it. And this guy's calling me all kinds of names. And that was, you know, 18 years ago. Since then, I've been called that repeatedly. And now it's like nothing. But I remember at one point, I would spend a lot of time stirring over these comments that were negative. And I would, you know, you see a lot of them. When Kyrie Irving got traded, I reported that he got traded to the Celtics. And, you know, I took a lot of flack for that. And I'm like, I'm just, you know, it's the old don't shoot the messenger line.
Right.
But I remember thinking at one point, you know, I'd get mad, I'd get angry, I didn't respond, but inside there was a lot of inner turmoil about these comments. And, you know, I remember praying about it and finding peace. And you know how you always have bring your kid to work day or whatever. I started looking at it. I had a slogan, bring Jesus to work day, you know, and that's every day. And I think that you realize when you are walking that walk with him leading the way, that these things, you do realize how inconsequential they really are. You know, sometimes people just want to be mad, you know, and I think it has changed. You know, when I was growing up, obviously during our era, if you had something to say, you would write a letter to the editor. You had to go through a bunch of different steps to get your anger out there. Now it's sudden. I think a lot of times it's misconstrued. I think sometimes maybe people sound angry about something and don't really mean it or whatever. But, you know, the Bible gives us all those principles. And like you said, Romans 1:17, really one sentence there lies it out for us, you know. And I think that, you know, you can find comfort in our faith in dealing with just about anything. And that's certainly one thing that, to me, when I get hate tweets or angry reactions, you know, I just look at it like, you know, we're all human and people are going to get angry at us no matter how perfect we may think we are sometimes. And in reality, if we're walking with the Lord, then, you know, that kind of stuff, eventually it brushes off. You can just brush it off and realize that that's really not part of the big plan. And we see it all the time in the Bible, right? Examples of some of the greatest leaders of that era constantly being questioned and getting their own sorts of hate, you know? And I think that's those examples that never goes away. As long as there's sin in the world, there's always going to be hate, anger, and all those emotions. So, yeah, I just look at it like, you know, a long time ago, have bring Jesus to work every day. And, you know, being a human being, sometimes it's easy to react to that stuff and let it impact you. But I think if you turn, just like everything else, if you turn it over to God, then you're going to be in a better spot. And that's where I found with that. And I think that, like you said, Aaron, that verse sums it up.
It's funny because it's like when you do your devotions in the morning and then something happens that day that applies directly to the devotion you did that morning. Last night, yeah. I was talking to my wife and it was a conversation. I promise you, it was not an argument. I swear it was not an argument. We were actually having a very in-depth conversation 27 years into marriage about, I was trying to tell her, like, what do you need from me? You know, whether it's praise or is there something around the house? Like, you know, what is it that I can hit the target of your heart as your husband? I want to hit the target. I don't want to be all over the, you know, I don't want to miss. And we just had this great conversation. But one of the things that she really said, back to what Mark said, is, you know, I don't need that from you. In essence, it's like, I get that from God. I don't, you know what I mean? And yes, she needs as her husband. She needs me to be, you know, a husband and a support. And for me, that was so hard to receive. Is it's like, yeah, but I want to do that for you. I want to be that, you know, and this is maybe on the other side, not the negative side, but the positive side is, hey, thanks for doing everything you did. Thanks for going to the grocery store. Like I sent her text, you know, hey, thanks for doing this. And I noticed this, I recognize this. And she was like, that's awesome. And this is just how my wife is wired. Not everyone is this way, but for her, she's like, that's awesome. But I get my, you know, I get my, you know, justification from Jesus. I like, he's all I need. You know what I mean? And she wasn't saying, I don't need you. But she was saying, like, you know, that's where my, to what Mark said, to really, Sam, what you said, that I get that from Jesus. And so if we keep our eyes on that, then the other stuff, good or bad, we don't get too high, we don't get too low. We don't, you know what I mean? So I'm just kind of summarizing, but it's funny. I just had that conversation last night. Thought that was very interesting.
Yeah, no doubt. I think, you know, we talk about it all the time. You know, who meets our needs? Our deepest need, only God can do that. Only Christ can do that. You know, we're not capable of human beings to totally. And I think that's what happens in so many problems in relationships, is that we look for other people to meet some kind of need.
Yeah.
You know, deep need within us. And I mean, we're going to let people down, you know? I mean, just ask my wife. I let her down all the time. You know, I mean,
amen.
as much as I love her, as much as I try to help her, you know, I mean, we're human beings. We make mistakes. We fall short, you know, as the scripture says, you know, we all fall short of his glory, you know, but he doesn't. And he knows, and he's always there, and he's the perfect father, and he's a perfect friend. And, you know, so keep our eyes on him and focused on him, you know, as like Sam said. I mean, I think that's great. Just that imagery of I'm taking Jesus to work with me every day. You know, I mean, how much better are you going to be decision wise and everything else if we literally think, which he is, but I mean, that's something we don't really think about, right? That he's sitting right next to us every day, you know, and that's who we have living within us, the Holy Spirit. But yet sometimes I don't really think about that the way that I should, you know, and to know that he's right there, it's going to help us make better decisions all the time.
And not do anything to grieve him.
Yeah. Yeah.
And those, you know, throughout the day with the Holy Spirit, I think we've talked about that before in this podcast. Don't do anything to grieve the Holy Spirit because he's in you. He's right with you. Don't do anything. Don't make decisions that would grieve the Holy Spirit because he's going to know. He's right there with you. Yeah. So, right? Good stuff, guys. And I hate to wrap. I know we're getting late, but thank you, Sam, for coming on, updating us on the Cavs. We are inching ever closer to, well, episode 100. We got an announcement coming probably within the next day or two here soon about who episode 100 is. But yeah, we're inching ever closer to college and NBA basketball, and it's the best time of the year.
Sam, does that mean I'm episode 99, by the way?
You're 97.
But, okay. All right.
No, I'm sorry. You're 96. You're episode 96. So we're four away, but you'll always be back. You're friend of show and always bring a lot of great, not only NBA insight, but also your faith aspect as well. We love having you on.
That's for sure. And Sam, I'm going to urge you to, you know, when the breaking news comes, I urge you to announce it here on the Mark Price for Three podcast. There you go.
That's a good urge. I could probably put that in the headline somehow. I appreciate you guys always having me on. And like I said, Aaron, it's right around the corner. It really is. I'm ready to get back into it. You know, by June, I'm a little bit worn out. Yeah. Ready to take a break. And then probably the third week of August, I'm like, okay, can we get this thing rolling again? You know, and I always look forward to that first week of training camp, media day, and all that stuff is always kind of pumps new energy back into me. And I think, wow, I get to do this now for, you know, 9 months or however long, 11 months anymore. So I appreciate you guys having me on all the time, not all the time, but I'm always grateful to come on is what I mean. So thanks so much. And I'm sure I'll talk to you again at some point soon.
Absolutely. Well, for Sam, for Mark, I'm Aaron. This has been episode 96 of the Mark Price for Three podcast. We urge you to follow, share, comment, and like, and we'll be back with you again next week for episode 97.
Thank you for listening to another episode of the Mark Price for Three podcast. Remember to subscribe, like, review, and share. I'm Josh Price, and we will talk to you again on the next episode.
You don't have to go very far looking for bad news because somehow it just finds you. So finding peace in the chaos can be really difficult, but it doesn't have to be because the River mobile app exists. The River is a Christian music radio station dedicated to playing music to help you get through life's toughest moments or life's happiest moments and everywhere in between. And all from artists who love Jesus and are real people just like you. Listening is easy. You can download it wherever you get apps from. Just search 1049 The River or listen online at riverradio.com.